everyone, welcome back to the Healthy Peace Soul podcast. I am so glad you are joining me this week as I continue my series on Ayurveda, an ancient system of wellness from India that truly is meaningful and practical to our modern lives. As you know, the state of well-being in the US is currently not optimal. Much of our healthcare paradigm is based on a we won't fix it until it's broken model, with little emphasis placed on how stress and the accelerated pace of our lives impact our health. Ayurveda is a paradigm which asks us to step up, to consider how every aspect of our lives influences our health. Instead of focusing on disease, Ayurveda attunes us to the subtle imbalances that percolate in our mind and physiology. When we are so attuned, we gain the capacity to align and realign. We become powerful instead of powerless. We gain the opportunity for perfect health. Every week, I explore these principles with a fascinating guest who is on the path, or I share what is resonating with me. Thank you for supporting this podcast and being a co-creator in conceiving of and participating in the new paradigm, the healthy, peaceful world. This afternoon, I have a wonderful guest, Gary Grewal, and Gary is the founder of an Ayurvedic herb and product company, Gary and Son. Today, we're going to jump around a bit in terms of topics. We're going to talk about Gary's journey to Ayurveda and alternative healing, how Gary came to start an Ayurvedic herb company in the U.S., the lessons he's learned along the way as an entrepreneur involved with Ayurveda, and where he hopes to see Ayurveda positioned in the future in the U.S. when more and more people are dissatisfied with conventional approaches to healing. Welcome, Gary.
Thank you.
Awesome. Yeah, so let's jump right in and talk a little bit about your background. I know you came to the U.S. from India. Maybe give us a little bit about your background and how you came to be involved initially and interested in Ayurveda, even before you started your company.
So I actually came in 1985 to USA. Just came for a visit. Then I continued here. I came for a business with a company in Connecticut. So then I went back after the visit. Then I came second time again. But then I, as explained last time, that I worked with Mrs. Field Cookies, if you remember, I was talking to you.
I do remember you actually, so you were working in a corporate job or for a corporation, not in alternative healing, but just in Mrs. Field's Cookies. Awesome. And was that in Connecticut or were you in Nevada at that time?
I was in Virginia.
In Virginia, okay. So you started working for Mrs. Fields. And so how did you jump from Mrs. Fields Cookies to Ayurveda?
So in 92, I went back to Dubai.
You went to Dubai, okay.
So I made friends there, Ayurvedic doctors. As I told Dr. K.L. Jain, they used to import the Ayurvedic stuff. And during that time in 19, before that, I was looking for something for me to understand because I lost my dad to heart attack in 1981 and lost
So you lost your dad in 81?
Yeah, heart attack, blood pressure, we call it.
Right.
Didn't know what to do at the time, 1981.
Okay.
And then I lost my mother to Alzheimer's, Parkinson's in India.
And was that close to the time your dad passed
that
away?
Around 7 to 10 years later, first my father died. Then.
So in the late 80s, early 90s.
Yeah.
And do you mind me asking how old your dad was when he passed?
62. My father was 62.
So he was still you know, a fairly young retired age, 62. And what was the impact of, tell me a little bit about the impact of those early deaths on you.
He died in front of me, actually.
Oh, okay. And
we had lunch together and we ate food together. And then after we finished eating, and he said, "Gary, I would like to take a rest on a bed." I said, "Okay." Yeah. So there, he went to the room, he lay down. And after around 20, 25, he called me, "Look, my tummy is not good. Give me a bottle of water, warm, which I want to roll on my tummy to feel I can digest my food." So I gave him the bottle and he was rolling on his tummy. But then again, he called about the Gary, "I think he's a little bit more. So why don't you sit next to us?" So I sat next to him. "What is going on? What is happening?" He said, "Everything is okay. It feels not feeling good. Can you give me water?" He said, "I mirror can't open my mouth. Can you put a teaspoon of water in my mouth?" We are communicating that. So I put that water in his mouth and I hear a sound, gong, you know, something like a sound in his body, and he's no more. And I don't know. I'm shaking him and waking him up. "Dad, what happened? Get up. Let's sit down." I have no clue. I got panicked. So we went to the, after around maybe half an hour, 1 hour, it took a little time for us to reach the hospital. In India, it takes a time because everything is not.
Yeah, of course, of course. It's not going to happen quickly. So.
Yeah, the doctor checked it. He said he's already dead, man.
Yeah.
So I didn't know how to do the CPR.
You weren't. And so the early deaths of your parents had an influence on you in terms of thinking about Ayurveda and alternative healing?
Something to learn. So I joined college. I did my pre-medical. So it's the prep medical, pre-medical. Next one is MBBS and MD. But I could not go to the college because we didn't have enough money to support.
Okay. But you did some college, you did pre-med?
Pre-medical I did. And then was meeting with these people in Dubai who are Ayurvedic people. I said, "Gary, you should do some courses. You should learn. It is a good opportunity for you to go to state. We will make things for you and we will able to help you." So Dr. K.L. Jain was the guy first I met in Dubai. And he was a Vedic astrologer as well.
So he was an Ayurvedic Vaidya doctor and a Vedic astrologer.
Vedic astrologer. His Ayurveda is called Vedic, V-E-D-I-C. So they will check your pulse. They check your pulse. They make a chart for you. You know, you can see, read the lines of your...
Of course. Of course, because we know that, you know, Ayurveda is in tune with nature, and of course, the planetary influences are important as well.
Absolutely.
Can I ask you, Gary, what you were doing in Dubai? You didn't go to Dubai initially for Ayurveda.
Shipping company. I opened a shipping company there.
Okay, so you were involved with shipping, with commerce and shipping. Okay.
People used to bring their medicines. I used to clear it from the port. That's how I get to know them. They used to bring the herbs, powders, and all that, and sell it in different parts of the countries.
Okay. So were you actually involved with, you were doing some inspection, that sort of thing?
Clearing of the goods.
Clearing. Okay. Yeah. So you first started to think about Ayurveda as a business when you were living and working in Dubai.
Yes.
And you were introduced to the Ayurvedic doctors.
Yeah.
And so how then did you come back to the U.S.? And tell me about the start of Gary and Son.
So I came in 1998, and then he came, the doctor, along with me too. He came and met me And then he said, you can start that, I will help you. So in July, August of 1999, I opened Gary and Son with one product called Roo Booty. If I explained you that, I remember R-U-S.
I do remember. Do you mind spelling that product? Is that possible?
R-U-H, Roo. Roo
yep.
means soul. Booty, B-O-O-T-Y, soul of herbs, H-E-R-B-S.
Soul of herbs.
Yeah,
Okay.
that was a...
So yeah, why is it called that? Is that like a master herb or a universal herb?
It is a combination of different herbs that calm our mind. Roo means soul, S-O-U-L. So it
right.
triggers
Yeah.
our soul to relax and calm the mind.
Right, because we know that even in modern medicine, many diseases start in the mind. The psychosomatic effect of, obviously we know in Ayurveda that everything is connected. That's what we learn. And most diseases and start with a feeling of unease, so really start in the mind. So that's, it sounds like that's a very important herb.
Correct, very, very.
Or
Because,
formula, it's a formula, right?
yeah, there's a combination of sandalwood and lily flowers and certain other thing is more of a aroma. You smell it, you touch it, you apply it, and it relaxes your mind, it calms your mind. And that was the first product made by that doctor for me to market that in USA. First step.
Okay, so this product was specially formulated for you and
Got
your
it.
company.
Got it.
Okay.
And he did not charge me any money either.
Okay, he didn't, he was, initially he didn't charge you anything to
I didn't have it.
establish the formulation and to create
Right.
it. Okay.
Created
Okay.
And then he
All
said,
right.
start selling it. Once you start selling it, you can start paying me. So he also
Sure.
came to me and visit many, many places. We used to go to healing arts center, yoga center.
Yeah, no, I'm going to get into that. But so you started actually in July of 99, you said, with this one product.
Correct, Roo Booty.
Okay. So in your first year in business, did you add other products during your first year, or were you really focused on this one product?
After, I think around when we were starting visiting people, the people were guiding us that they need supplements too. Just one item is not enough for a health food store or a store. They might add something else. And then we discussed with that doctor. He said, yes, we can make freeze-dried supplements of Amalaki, Ashwagandha, Shatavari, generalize 20,
right.
25 different kind of
Now,
herbs.
Are these tablets in tablet form?
Capsules.
Capsules. Okay. Yeah. All right. So you started also to sell just the single Ayurvedic herbs.
Yes, that time.
Okay. All right.
So
I know I go ahead.
Go ahead, tell me.
I know you were at one point, when you and I talked before, you indicated that it was challenging at the beginning because you weren't known.
Yes.
Now you've been in business for 25 years and you wanted to find a way to really grow your business and to really to expose Ayurveda to the US market. And so tell me a little bit about how you went about that, what your journey was in that regard.
So after around year and around 2000, 2001, I met another doctor because I put an ad that I want Rasayana Prash, a herb general tonic for the body. If somebody is making it, not into a jam but in granule form. Then one of the doctors, Dr. Rajesh Kotecha, got involved with me. So he came to meet me in India in 2001. So then I was thinking, because I was traveling shop to shop, people do not care with you. You are sitting outside. They will call you at their own special time after half an hour or 1 hour. Or sometimes they will say, you know, I have no time. Sometimes they say, you know, I don't want to see you. So I was thinking, what best option I do? So I started going to seminars. It's called International Aroma Association in Arizona. I've been there, and there was something in Baltimore. I got my herbs there, but it was not still what exactly I wanted. I wanted to reach the people close enough who can understand, or we make them understand, what is Ayurveda. They don't know. So my mind tells me that why don't we start going to their centers, sit down there, check in the community wise, meet them one-on-one, start the consultation, and build our relationship close enough with them and guide them. What is Ayurveda? So that came after 2 years.
Okay, so you wanted to, obviously you wanted to grow your business, and you wanted to increase the awareness in the US market of Ayurveda.
Correct.
And how valuable it could be to overall wellness and health. And so you started to go to centers, and you giving, yeah, with this Vaidya, he was giving the one-on-one consultations. Was that be so correct?
People, that local center, they, yeah, will organize our lectures and consultations. So we will come there as a team. So the doctor will go to the individual one-on-one, sit down with her, check her pulse, tongue analysis, listen to them, guide them, what are the imbalances, what is Ayurveda, why we use it, all the details in 45 minutes to 1 hour, given them, and then we guide them, and he will write certain herbs for me. So then the person will come to me downstairs, so I will meet that client to see how did you do it. What do you think? Everybody is a new science. I don't know, but I don't mind to try it.
Sure, sure. So the centers that you're referring to, are these like yoga centers?
Healing arts center. First, we have
healing arts.
Healing arts center.
Okay.
So we have a big center in Omaha, Nebraska. First time where we go.
And were you doing business in Reno, Nevada? I know you're in Reno now,
yes,
but at that time,
were
you also?
My base was Reno while I was traveling.
You were traveling, okay. So to some extent, with Ayurveda, you really had to take the show on the road.
Yes, I was on the road and still go on the road to different states. Now, my doctor is coming on 2nd, 3rd of October, I will be in Traverse City, Michigan.
Right, that's a beautiful area, Traverse City.
I was there last year, so I still go twice a year.
Okay, all right. And when you do these visits, you always have an Ayurvedic doctor with you?
Yes, always doctor with me. So they come from India. They are the real doctor who spend 6-7 years studying Ayurveda, because what the Ayurveda being taught here in the colleges is 6 Ayurvedic specialists, Ayurvedic this, Ayurvedic that, but they do not have enough knowledge to give you a good thing of your body analysis, imbalances, and write the right thing what they need to do.
You make a good point. The you're talking about an Ayurvedic doctor who has the BAMS from India, from a college in India, essentially. Right, BAMS. Okay.
So they are real doctors. They studied 6-7 years in college.
Yeah. Obviously, in the U.S., we have Ayurvedic practitioners, Ayurvedic health counselors. But I believe there's only one school right now that actually has an Ayurvedic doctor program. So it's just not available here. So there's a different level of education, no doubt.
Correct.
So in doing these consultations and in going to these centers, there's some other things you were doing. I believe when you and I chatted before, you said you were actually cooking for people there.
So what in Omaha, so I told them to reach somebody, it is always the food. So why don't we teach them the Ayurvedic cooking or a vegetarian cooking? So I said, why don't we make a cooking class? So we did cooking class also in Omaha. Subsequently, every lunchtime, I used to cook for the whole center. There were massage therapists, there were the doctors, visitors, clients, us. So I will make around 12, 15 people food, rice and rice lanterns, like vegetables. So I used to make for them, and we all eat together. So that was where we were more comfortable, getting more closer. That, you know, there is a science exists. This is the food. It's a tasty food. It has the spices, because we taught them that turmeric is just not a color. It's a spices. It's antibiotic, antiseptic, anti-inflammatory, antioxidant. There are so many properties of those spices which you are putting in your food to digest better. So that helped them a lot. And I could able to sell my spices, because I used to get spices, tablets. Once I got this doctor, I used to import a lot more than normal.
Awesome, so awesome. So the meal was, it sounds like having that Ayurvedic lunch together was an important part of you promoting what it is that you were doing.
Yes.
You got to share food, but you also had an opportunity to educate. Was there anything else with the meal that you think was important?
That was the important thing, that people should eat that kind of a meal at least once a day, instead of eating same meal over and over and over. Because you put barbecue sauce, you put ketchup, you put this, you don't put spices. Whatever the burger you gave, so we were try to promote that the spices are best food. There's this Ayurvedic spices, turmeric, cumin, coriander, fennel, ginger, asafoetida. They were not aware of it. And I made them to be aware and guide them what are the properties of each herb, how it will help you in digesting the food. And they were feeling very good. And that's how I developed for the past 23 years, I still cook when I there. We didn't go
you
last.
You still cook?
If I go now, for the last 2 years, there is something with that lady. She wanted to lease her building. So it didn't go last year. But this year I'm going, I don't think I'm going to cook this time. But maybe in the future, if they settle down with some kind of a building, have a kitchen, I don't mind to cook again for that group.
Well, that's pretty amazing, because most business owners aren't going to go in there and cook a meal for everyone.
I do. And I feel proud, and I feel happy, and I feel complete that I did good some for somebody, change their lifestyle, and they are cooking, add the food so that they can able to make at home. We'll tell them go to Indian store. We'll tell them to go buy this stuff, all this stuff. Then we brought that khichdi, we call it. I don't know if you know that word.
Sure, the khichdi, which would be the dal and the rice and the mung beans.
The doctor was smart. I told him, why don't you make khichdi? raw, people can just put water and eat it once at a time. So we made vata khichdi, pitta khichdi, kapha khichdi.
You sell that as a product, like a
as
dehydrated.
A product also, when I'm there, I will cook. When I'm not there, you don't have to worry. Just take this combination, which is raw, but it is all mixed with the different spices. Add some 2 times water, cook it for 20, 25 minutes and eat a meal. And you can add some vegetables. And if you eat some meat, you can add that too, but make a full meal. But make sure you take khichdi once a day.
Sure, sure. So you have been in business, Gary and Son. Now it sounds like it's about 25 years.
Yes.
Obviously, how about sharing a couple of lessons learned along the way as a business owner in the U.S. with the kind of work that you've been doing in terms of promoting Ayurveda, selling Ayurvedic herbs and supplements?
So the lesson is patience, education to the public, make them understand the value of the herbs and the value of Ayurveda where it comes from, instead of just selling, take the Amalaki. No, what is Amalaki? What is Ashwagandha? How did the knowledge, education was the main goal of guiding them. That is how I was promoting Ayurveda, because educating them, if the doctor wrote some combination, let's say, Lagu Shuddha Shekhar, some tablet. So I must tell them the combination is made like this. This is what are the functions of this. This is what it's going to do to your body. So when you take it, this will help you with this. So we were guiding them. We were making them understand that this will be helpful to you, to your body. This is what is made. Hear the literature. Guide them or go to Google. At that time, the things were coming into Google also. So to understand it. So I think main subject was, I spent half an hour to 45 minutes after the doctor to explain them what he has written to you.
Right. So you feel that in your business, the fact that you have given that personal attention and education,
yes.
It's not just writing a script or there's a formula, and but you're really letting people know why this is beneficial, what the benefits are. And so they have a deeper understanding of what is it that they're entering into.
And then also, I always tell them, please just go to be open, because we write the name of the plant. So you can able to get the properties of the plant, what it does to you. So as a supplementation, you can look at it. So people
they have the information. So if they want to delve in deeper, they have the ability to do so. Okay.
Yes. So that
now,
is what,
great. How many products do you approximately have today that you're selling?
I will say we have more than 300 now.
Okay. All right. And is that first product still a good seller for you?
Rue Booty still sells as of today. And Granular Sanapra still sell as of today. We brought Shtavari Kalpa, still sells as of today. We don't amend, we add more and more for different ailments. And make the adjustment with the Dr. Kuruchak, he taught me. I spent almost 18 years, 17 years with him. He taught me. We went to his scent clinic, learned from his clinic, learned from him the combinations and formulas. And the other thing, which normally people don't do it, all the colleges, this is something I don't know if people know about it or not. The students study, once they pass out, there is nobody to mentor them.
Are you talking about here in the U.S.?
Yes.
Oh, that's definitely true. That's a big problem with Ayurveda. Yeah.
So
in terms of really trying to grow Ayurveda, you know, that the students do need mentors.
Correct. So what commented we come into play then, student in the past, the college used to get hers from me. They said, talk to Gary. I was the one who was talking, interacting with them. They will ask me questions. I will able to answer their questions and help them guide through whatever I know. And if I don't know, I will go to my doctor in India and ask what things are to be given for this specific problem faced by a student here in USA. So I will tell that person will say, Gary, why don't you make it for me, ship it to me, so that will increase my business. So that help I rendered without taking money, no money at all, but it helped me to make my business more better. I could make her a distributor for that particular state. She will keep my stuff and sell to her clients.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense. Well, I mean, you're essentially providing a service. You're acting as a mentor. And by, you know, offering that assistance, you're establishing rapport, trust, credibility. And so obviously they'd like to use you and help you if they can. Obviously, it's establishing a relationship. And that's really smart in terms of reaching the students and reaching the new practitioners who are out there. And you're right, there isn't necessarily a lot of support available and mentorship.
People don't do it, but as of today, I still have plenty of people call me and ask me what I know. I still share with them. I have no problem in communicating with them. I have no problem sharing the formula. I have no problem in spending time with them to talk to them for half an hour, 20 minutes, and they are wonderful and they buy. And that is one of the key business reason that our business is in all states. If you go to New York, somebody knows Gary and Son. If you go to New Jersey, somebody knows Gary and Son. You go to Pennsylvania, you go to Virginia, you go to Maryland, somebody, because people are scattered, they keep on going there.
Of course. It sounds like you've not only established these contacts, but you've cultivated them. You've cultivated them over the years.
Yes.
Do you want to share, without naming any names, a success story of a client who your doctor has worked with, maybe that you have provided some service to, something that you can share with our viewers and listeners that might interest them in learning more about Ayurveda?
So initially, I will share with you, we had a case in Omaha. The doctor was with me. She used to get a lot of cramps. Her mother used to get, and the daughter too. Menstrual cramps. And they were on the floor.
Oh, so very painful.
Very painful, because mother used to get, and the daughter too. So that was a main challenge, how to subside the cramps which they were experiencing for the past 15, 20 years. Mother was experiencing.
Yeah.
And same as passing on to the juror. That was our success story, that after 3 to 4 months of taking this supplement advised by the Vaidya from India, they subsided the cramps. So that was our biggest win victory in Omaha, that people got healthy and better and they loved us. That was in first stage in Omaha we did it. I don't want to name
right.
it. I don't want to.
No, of course not. Well, that's wonderful. That's certainly very, very helpful. Now in India, we hear a lot about the toxicity in terms of the herbs. So how do you ensure that your herbs are safe and without toxins? Or
so when we bring our herbs, we get the heavy metal tested. We laid mercury, cadmium, and arsenic, and micro are tested by a third party testing.
Okay.
It's a company called Eurofins, EUROFIN, is a European company in India. they test our products. So we are very cautious and very careful nowadays, much more conscious and careful that our products are tested for heavy metals. So that is the one part. Now, for the past 2.5 years, we have opened our own Garians company in India. That everything is done at that part, and we bring stuff from the company to here, which is all clean. Like I give you example of very popular items, Shilajit. You know, if you heard the
name. Right. Yes, of course, Shilajit. Yeah.
So it's very popular. That's the problem. People are selling Shilajit 20%, Shilajit 50%, Shilajit. So how can you assess percentage of Shilajit? Either it is Shilajit or it is not Shilajit.
Yeah, it's not 100%. It's not pure, essentially.
Correct. So we make our Shilajit. You make the same stone, you bring it, everybody get. How to clean it? We clean with Trifla.
Okay.
And we boil it and scoop it. Keep on. I spend 21 days scooping the Shilajit out of the barrel every day, cooking at 40 to 50, 60 degree temperature low. And it took us 21 days. And today, our fulvic acid is 80.75%. Nobody has it. Cleaning.
Right. So you're really dedicated to purity.
Pure.
So has this been a new stage for you, having a company that actually produces the herbs in India?
Yes.
This is new for you.
It is new now. We used to get from many, many before that.
Right.
And especially if I go to somebody, I go to their company, go to their warehouse, go to their factory. How do they make, spend 2-3 days, 4 days with them before I could get them to India to make sure it is all clean, it is nothing is wrong with that. People play the trick, but still our motto was to bring the best to the community. Today, I am supplying to a lot of colleges. They have their, I'm putting to, one of them is Mark Thumi. You know, I supply them too.
Yes, the Raj, yep.
The Raj, I supply to the Ayurvedic Institute, Santalad. I supply to Mount Madonna. I supply to the Ayurvedic Grass Valley College of Ayurveda. I supply to Kerala Ayurvedic College too. So
okay, so you really are. And the when you are producing your own herbs, you're able to have better quality control. But is there an impact on greater availability when you're producing your own versus buying herbs from another supplier? Or are there other reasons why you want to produce your own?
Now we cannot produce everything, but we can source it from one place or second place. Bring it as a plant or as cut and shift, not as a powder.
Sure.
So when you get a plant, so we know, let's see ashwagandha. So we only need ashwagandha roots. We don't need ashwagandha plant.
Yeah.
So we will want to make sure the plant roots are thick enough. The person who works with me, who's our employee, he's a microbiologist, Dr. Sudhir. His job, we have our own lab internally. First time, as soon as the shipment land, we tested the viability. Is it really ashwagandha? It is really the root, not the trunk or not the leaves. Once that is authenticated, then we bring into our inventory, then washing it, cleaning it, warming it, cooking it, powdering it, testing it. Everything we do is for the scratch from there.
It sounds like you really high attention to quality, and obviously, if the schools are purchasing from you, you know that really says something in terms of the quality that you provide. Thank you for that. What do you think about growing Ayurveda in the U.S.?
There are people are trying, but there are Ayurvedic herbs, certain herbs, you cannot grow in USA because of the weather conditions.
Oh, I know about the herbs, but growing the attention to Ayurveda, like getting more people interested in Ayurveda, how do you think that's going to happen in the US?
See, I was thinking that, but then it was kind of a very, I don't know what are the rules and regulations for it, because it is different as compared to India, because I'm a farmer. So I have my own land. I can
Of
grow
course.
anything in that land. But when it comes here, there is companies in Oregon, they are growing some ashwagandha, some guttuchi, and I love to be a part of them and I want to do it, but I do not know the procedure.
Yeah, well, that would be a whole other aspect. My question actually relates less to the actual growing of the herbs in the ground, but more about how do you envision getting more and more people interested in Ayurveda in the US?
So I remember the last time we discussed that first Ayurveda should be recognized by the USA government as a mode of system, mode of health system. Initially, when people go, everybody should not go to the hospital. You have a headache, you go to the doctor. I know if it is serious, you can go, but first it should go to a Ayurvedic professional or a doctor who can able to look at you. If you, by giving certain supplements, some sports, some meditation, some yoga, something given, if you feel better with that, you don't need to take chemicals, pills. But when you don't, then you go to them. So my vision will be, if somebody comes to me or somebody comes to the office, I will try to help them first in an Ayurvedic way, in a combination way, communication, talking, listening, guiding them yoga or meditation and the supplementation. And if they can't do something, they can't help it, they can go to the hospital. Hospital should not be the first stage. It should be the second stage. Okay, surgery, we can't do nothing. It should go to the doctor. But minor
Yeah,
pain.
So it sounds like what you're advocating is an integrative approach.
Yes.
But that Ayurveda has a lot to offer from really a prevention
Yes.
Standpoint, and that if clients can avoid toxic pharmaceuticals, that's certainly preferred because there's many, many side effects.
Correct. And the Ayurveda doesn't have a side effect. You should try. I want to advocate, and most of the people which come, just think on it, what is Ayurveda, listen about it, talk about it, and get the guidelines. Sometimes we talk just changing the food habits. We check the pulse, okay, you are Vata, so you don't need to take these things. You can't take spicy food. You don't take these things. Oh, I love spicy, but that is not your body type. So by
yeah,
changing
yeah,
the diet,
that's a great point.
changing
That's a
the
great point
diet,
about diet.
changing the routines of the door, changing the activities, you feel better, your health automatically. If you are a kapha, you are taking a lot of sweets, it's not good for you. You need to energize your body. So by changing the habits, day-to-day activities, that will change a lot for your physical health, and Ayurveda can help along with it. And it doesn't cost much. It's just a information given to them, or they can read a book on Ayurveda.
Yeah, I mean, Ayurveda is all about habit change. So I love that because it's really habit change. Gary, I've got some, I like to call this section really a lightning round. So I'm just going to ask you some rapid fire questions. And just, whatever comes top of mind to you, just respond. Okay. The first one is, what is your favorite Ayurvedic herb?
Say again.
Your favorite Ayurvedic herb or herbal formula?
Single herb will be ashwagandha.
Okay. Do
And
you want to name a formula?
And the combination is clostrovin. good for cholesterol.
Oh, is that something you sell?
But I take it every day because
Oh, excellent.
because I'm
Right.
pitta, because I'm pitta. So pitta tend to have more cholesterol already. So we need to balance your cholesterol to keep your heart healthy.
Excellent. How about your favorite Ayurvedic food or meal?
Khichdi. Pitta khichdi.
Okay, so what spices and what basmati and mung dal or something else?
Basmati, mung dal, cumin, coriander, turmeric, hing, all the combinations in there.
Okay. And would you use different spices if you were doing a vata khichdi?
I will always add extra spices too. Yes.
Okay. All right. What's your favorite, personally, what's your favorite time of day and why?
Morning is my best because I like to get up early in the morning, go for a walk. I'm more fresh in the morning.
Excellent. Do you have a Dinacharya that you follow?
In the morning, yes. Prayer is very important. Meditation is very important. Coming in time is very important. Getting up in time is very important before sun rises. Walk is very important in the morning. And then come to the office.
Why is it important to get up before sunrise?
It's in our tradition that you must get up before the sun rises because it has lots of energy. Your vata is getting up. And if you go in the morning or before the sun rises, you do many things before that, and then you see the sun and pray while it is coming up on the rock. I see 13 seconds to 20 seconds into the sun to keep my eyes better. There was an article I was reading from doctors from Europe that if you put your eyes straight 13 seconds every day, you may not get a cancer. I don't know how far is that true, but I have a routine that when I get up in the morning, I do go light, not at 12 o'clock, but it will be between 7 to 8 or 9 when the sun is not too strong. But you look at in the sun and pray, and that helps you. You don't get cancer. That is what they said.
Beautiful, beautiful. I love it. The word balance is used a lot in Ayurveda. What does this word mean for you?
Which one?
The word balance.
Balance. Balance is all your doshas are balanced. That means to keep yourself healthy, happy, and pass on the good vibes to your family. Because those are good vibes to your family, to your wife, to your children, to your friends, to your clients. When you are balanced, you can able to guide them in a balanced way. If you are not balanced, you are imbalanced, you can't help other people. First, balance is very important for me, for my family, for our clients.
Yeah, that's beautiful because what you're indicating is, you know, the balance is not just for you. Obviously, it's going to help you in your personal health, but it's also going to have a ripple effect. It's going to impact your customers. It's going to impact your family. It's going to impact your acquaintances, your friends.
Absolutely.
So I really love that. Thank you.
Absolutely.
What's the best way to communicate with Americans about Ayurveda?
Educate them, talk to them, advise them, make them sit next to you, make them friends close enough. Just don't reading a book. Instead of be practical with them.
Right. So you just really have to give that personal attention, listening, and consulting in a way that's caring and considerate and respectful.
Absolutely. Be respectful because they don't know. You need to guide them. People come here to my office. I get up. I go from my office to meet them, to greet them, even though I have employees. But I would like to thank you so much for coming. We are this science. We have this issue. This is what we are doing. I hope we can able to help you. Tell me, is there anything I can do for you? And
yeah.
Bring them here. Talk to them. so that they understand it. It is just not a fictional science giving you a bottle, take two tablets twice a day. It is science.
Right.
You need
well,
to do.
Caring has a lot to do with healing as well.
Absolutely. Caring, acknowledging, and greeting them, respect of them, bring them closer to you, your family, friend, makes a difference.
Absolutely. What does the word wholeness mean to you?
Holiness.
Wholeness.
Wholeness, no. Is, again, if you are balanced, your wholeness is your own body. You need to be good. Holiness means your wholeness, your whole body. Everything should be attained towards the Ayurveda and helping people.
Beautiful. Thank you. Do you have a favorite book or resource about Ayurveda?
I do a lot of research and read the books. I go online most of the time to make the formulas, go through different combinations and communicate with my doctor in India to make the formulas.
Great. The next one is, think about Ayurveda is all about universal principles.
Correct.
Are there five principles that you think Americans can start doing right away that are Ayurvedic principles that will improve their health?
We all are made from the five principles. Everybody has to follow this. And under those five principles, we have doshas. We follow the doshas. If you can follow the dosha, balance your dosha, you don't need a doctor. You need to balance your body. So the doshas and five elements are the key thing in my science of Ayurveda. So we follow that. And everybody should follow that to keep themselves healthy and balance their dosha. We all know what vata needs, pitta needs, kapha needs. So your needs are there. If you follow that, you don't have to be 100%. You follow 60, 70%, you stay healthy.
Yeah, that's a really great point. I mean, the reality is we're never going to be 100% balanced, but we have
never.
To know what our tendencies are.
Yes.
And our, you know, how we go out of balance and really to try to work with our own individual tendencies, our own individual doshas.
These are all five elements. Those are the, then comes the doshas. So it's pitta, vata, pitta, kapha. If you can align them, balance them, you don't need to need a doctor because body itself is a doctor. It heals itself. But you need to balance it by taking certain things and changing your habits.
Yeah, that's beautiful. That's beautiful because, you know, Ayurveda is known as a system of self-healing.
Self-healing.
We have to activate the body's own inclination toward healing. So
very important.
Gary, I would like to tell our listeners and viewers where they can find you and your company.
So my company name is Gary and Son USA, and I am based at 650 South Rock Boulevard, Building 14B, and we are in Reno, R-E-N-O, state is Nevada, N-E-V-A-D-A, zip is 89502. They can call us at 775-826-6004. They can call us on our toll-free number, 1-888-984-3727.
Great. I'll include all of those in the show notes. And your website is Gary and Son USA?
www.garrison, GARRYSUN.com.
.com. GARRYSUN.com.
Yes.
Gary's Son. Great.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Gary, any final words for our viewers and listeners?
Thank you.
Awesome. Any final words about Ayurveda, healing, that you want to share with our viewers and listeners?
My request to all my fellow friends, family people, please incorporate Ayurveda in your daily routine and get yourself balanced and get a help from a professional if you need. Otherwise, Ayurveda is a self-healing science. You can take a book. You don't have to be a doctor. You can take a book, read about it. Read about you, because you need to get balanced. Your family need to get balanced. Your friends need to get balanced and stay healthy. Thank you and namaste.